Okay, so good afternoon and a warm welcome to all. And thank you for joining this session, today's session on Platform Society. And we are conducting this session under the web lecture series of Surendranath College for Women. My name is Autoshi Bhattacharya. And Surendranath College for Women needs no introduction. And our Department of Journalism of Mass Communication, is one of the college's vibrant and lively department with proactive students and unmatched faculty members. Today, as I said, we are presenting on Platform Society. If you have any doubts, queries, and suggestions during the presentation, please type them into the chat box. We will have a question and answer session at the end, and we will surely attend to them. Link for the feedback will also be provided into the chat box. So kind, be very attentive, careful while filling up your credentials to receive your e-certificates. Without any further delay, let me begin this session by inviting today's speaker, Jyoti Shaw. Jyoti Shaw is a faculty of our department, faculty at Department of Journalism and Mass Communication, Surendranath College for Women. She is also a guest faculty at THK Jain College. She completed her post-graduation from Department of Journalism and Mass Communication, University of Kolkata, and she is a gold medalist. So today, it's my proud privilege to invite Jyoti on this virtual platform. So Jyoti, over to you.
Thank you, Atashidi, for the introduction and your kind words. Before I begin my presentation for the day, I would like to specially thank Dr. Uma Shankar Pandey sir for giving me this wonderful opportunity and platform to talk about Platform Society. Yes, today I'm going to present on the topic Platform Society. So allow me to present. Is my screen visible?
Yes.
So yes, Platform Society. The topic to be covered in the web lecture are concept of platform, elements that construct a platform, concept of platform society, concept of platform economy, type of platforms, concept of platformization, how online platforms are reshaping the four important sectors that are urban sector, urban transport sector, health sector, education sector, and news sector. And at the end, we'll conclude by focusing on towards a value-centric design of platform society. So let us discuss about the concept of platforms. An online platform is a programmable digital architecture designed for convenient access and interaction between two or more distinct but interdependent set of users, over here individual and firm, who interact through the service via the internet. So I'm going to explain the concept of platform with the help of an example. So over here, I have taken the example of Facebook Newsfeed, which is a platform. Facebook Newsfeed has a programmable digital architecture, and it is designed for the convenient access and interaction by individual, as the Facebook newsfeed, an individual can gather information and news from easily from Facebook newsfeed, and by the firm, Facebook newsfeed also provide news organization with real-time analytics focused on audience attention and thus shaping the editorial decision making in terms of topics to focus on and reconfigure the presentation of content. And both of them interact through the service via the internet. So what are the elements that construct an online platform? The first element is it is fueled by data, automated and organized through algorithms, formalized through ownership relation driven by business model, governed through user agreements. So now let us discuss about fueled by data, the first element. Platform automatically collects a large amount of data. Devices we use to access platform services often come equipped with software and apps that can automatically collect data, not just internet protocol address and geolocation, but detailed information about interest, preference, and taste. By means of application interface, application programming interface, API, platforms offer third-party controlled access to their platform data, the data which they collect, giving them detailed insight into their behavior, into the user's behavior and metrics, information on which they can build new application or platform. Thus, data provide the fuel for growing connectivity between platforms. Over here, I have given an example of eBay. eBay launched the first open API in the year 2000, and its global employment has transformed the web into a data-driven platform-based ecosystem. Now we use the web to get data. The big companies, the big five, we can say, like Google and, you know, everyone, they render their the data to the other third party so that they can use it to make new platforms. Automated and organized through algorithms. Platforms are automated and organized through algorithms. Algorithms are set of automated instruction to transform input into a desired output. Platform use algorithms to automatically filter enormous amount of content and connect users to content service and advertisement. Over here, I've given an example of Facebook newsfeed again. Facebook newsfeed algorithms determine the content you will be exposed to, calculated on the basis of online activities of friends and friends of friends. So many a times we see that whenever we are searching something on the Facebook or we are on the Facebook newsfeed, we automatically, you know, are exposed to certain news that we have already liked or our friends or friends of friends have liked. So these are the functions of algorithms. Now, formalized through ownership relation, driven by business model. Now let's come to the ownership. Each platform has a specific legal economic status. It may be operated on a profit or a non-profit basis. It is relevant for the user to recognize owner-consumer relationship, especially because they may change over time. Now this point, I have taken an example of Couchsurfing. Couchsurfing Incorporated, the hospitality site, started in 2005 as a Couchsurfing Collective, with local teams operating from the United States, Canada, Australia, and New Zealand. When the site changed from a volunteer-based organization financed by donation to a corporation in 2011, many members objected to the shift from a non-profit traveler network to a profit accommodation site. So the platform might change the ownership format. Business model. Business model in this context of platform refers to the way in which economic values get created and captured. Along with money and attention, data and user valuation has become popular means of monetization. Facebook, Twitter, and Google Plus are just a few of the many online social networks that are monetized through the automatic connection between user content, data, and advertising. YouTube, we see that if we get 1,000 subscribers, then we can start our, you know, we can monetize our program. So governed through user agreement. The user agreement usually called the terms of service. These are pseudo-legal contracts that define and shape the relationship between the user and the platform owner. But they are often long, difficult to understand, and subject to constant change, which is why many people check the box without even looking at this agreement. But these terms of condition serve. These terms of condition does a lot more than just define the service condition. It can be used to impose norms or values with regard to privacy. It may also state the privileges platform owners and their customer have. So we can conclude that each platform is a separate entity with a unique combination of features. It can only operate as a part of larger ecosystem. So after the elements that construct a platform, we'll come to the concept of platform society. Platform society can be defined as a term that intensifies the inseparable relation between online platform and various sectors of the society and the government as well. This definition is given by Josef van Dyck. Let me play a video. So the concept of platform was, you know, elaborated and illustrated in this particular video. I have also explained the platform society with an example that how the relationship between the online platform and various sectors of the society and government are inseparable. For example, if you take an example of Uber as an online platform, the individual and individual driver with the car are part of the sectors of the society, and the highway and traffic controller are provided by the government. So we cannot separate Uber with the individual driver or with car or the highway and traffic. We need all the three things together for the platform to work in the society. Now the concept of platform ecosystem. Platform ecosystem is an assemblage of network platform governed by a particular set of mechanism that shapes everyday practice. The platforms are not standalone sites or similar facilitators, but they are strongly connected to each other. So we can highlight this point by, you know, focusing in this diagram. Over here we can see the and this circle constant of platform, platform owners and platform providers. Over here, platform owners are the controller of the platform IP and arbiter who may participate and in what ways. Google owns Android and the mobile devices. Platform providers are the mobile devices are providers on Android. Now the platform producers and platform consumers. The platform producers are the creator of platform offerings. For example, apps on Android. And the consumers are the buyer or user of the offerings. So this constitute, and yes, of course, the government system, the rules for participation, reward system, conflict resolution. So there exists the producer, the consumer, the platform owner, producer, providers, and the government system. This construct the entire platform ecosystem. Okay, now types of platform. The first type of platforms we can highlight is the infrastructural platform. Infrastructural platform provides services which include search engine, browser, data server, cloud computing, email, instant messaging, and many more. For example, we can highlight, see this, this is Alphabet Google. These are the big five. In the diagram, you can see that Alphabet Inc. Incorporated, that is Google, Facebook, Apple, Microsoft Corporation, and Amazon.com. So these are the big five. So if we focus on Google, we can see that they provide YouTube, they provide Gmail, they provide Google Search, they provide Google Docs, Google Chrome. Similarly, Facebook also provides many apps like Newsfeed, WhatsApp, Instagram. So these are the infrastructure platform which provide a number of services. So to conclude, the infrastructure platforms are mostly owned and operated by the big five, Alphabet, Google, Facebook, Apple, Amazon, and Microsoft, and they form the heart of the ecosystem upon which many other platforms and apps can be built. So this is about infrastructure platforms. Now, another type, or the second type of platform is sectoral platform. Sectoral platforms serve a particular sector. Over here, serve a particular sector means Uber serves the urban transport. And over here, Coursera serves the education sector. Facebook Newsfeed serves the news sector. So the sectoral platform serves a particular sector. Some of the best known sectoral platforms are merely connectors between individual and individual user and single providers. Over here, we can take the example of Uber. Uber is just a mere connector which, you know, Uber is a platform that connects the individual user. Like if you want to book a Uber with the help of a smartphone and with the help of the app, Uber app, we can connect with the individual driver, you know, with the driver with the car. So Uber is a sectoral platform that act as a mere connector between the individual user and the single provider. So now let us focus on the concept of platformization. The status of platform is subject to continuous change, a process which we call platformization. The term infrastructural and sectoral platform, connectors and complementers, should therefore be best understood as roles and relationships that particular actors takes on rather than on fixed category. These roles also shift over time and through context. So over here, I have given an example of Uber again. Uber can serve as a connector, it can serve as a complementer, and it can also serve as infrastructural platform. Uber serves as a connector when it matches the driver and passenger through its standalone platform. Uber serves as a complementer when its service is offered as one of the many transport providers through an integrated transport platform such as mobility as service. Uber serves as an infrastructural platform if it offers a reputation system or mapping data to a third party. So this is how, you know, Uber can take the role, can play the role of a connector, complementer, and infrastructural platform. So the continuous change, a process we call, this is called platformization. Thus, platformization refers to the way in which the entire societal sector are transforming as a result of mutual shaping of online connectors and complementers. Now we will focus on the four important sectors of platform society. So online platforms are reshaping the four important sectors: urban transport sector, health sector, education, and news sector. So let us focus on our first sector, urban transport sector. The new sectoral platform for urban transport that have arisen in the mid-2010 have tremendously enlarged consumer mobility options. Platformization affects the entire sector, effectively blurring the division between private and public transport modalities. Existing public-private arrangements have started to shift as a result. Now we will look into the shifts. Transport network companies. Now transport network companies, also known as ride-hailing companies, provide on-demand transportation service for passengers. Passenger requests a ride directly from the private drivers under the contract with a TNC, usually through the use of a smartphone app. Noteworthy example of transport network companies include Uber and Lyft. So these are the transport network company, and it is something new in the urban sector, urban transport sector. Now another new platform is the connected platform such as Zoomcar. Next to TNC, other connected platforms have arisen that provided access to vehicle rented out by private car owners or companies. So Zoomcar holds the distinction of being India's first self-driven mobility platform. So now the new thing that the platform have, you know, this new platform has given us is that we can rent a car. We can take a car on rent for maybe, you know, on hourly basis, on day, on basis of day, week, or month. So previously, you know, it is something different from the traditional urban transport sector. Another new thing is the connected platform such as Google Map. Mapping applications are set to take up the central role as transport portals. For instance, people looking for travel direction on Google Map are automatically offered various options from walking, biking, and public transport to directly ordering an Uber. So now let us focus on healthcare and health research sector. Online health platforms are booming, ranging from personal fitness app to health and sickness platform. Online health platforms are used both by the patient as well as the institute and doctor and researchers. It can be, on one hand, they offer personalized data services to their customers. On the other hand, they apparently also serve the overall public interest in medical research, the outcomes of which benefit everyone. There is a spectacular growth in online services promising to advance health, fitness, and physical or mental well-being of the user. So these are some of the new platforms that is in the health sector. Fitness app. These apps are mostly used for tracking a person's physical performance. This is an example I've given is a fitness buddy. It is like a virtual personal trainer as well as a nutritionist. And another example is Map My Run. It is a great app for tracking and mapping all the runs. Another new platform is a medical app. These apps are meant for self-diagnosis, to monitor symptoms in order to prevent or treat diseases, and to help the patient cope with their ailment. Doc app is an app. Doc app is an app for online doctor consultancy, where the patient can ask health or medical questions to specialist doctor for diagnosis and medical advices, and a specialist doctor will be appointed to you instantly after one-time consultant fee. Doc app is also your online medical record. Another example is Practo. It is an online doctor consultant app, and the patient are not required to travel anymore. The patient can directly ask a doctor about their health concern over a video call or chat. Health monitoring platforms. These platforms help individuals to track vital signs, health-related behaviors, or symptoms for disease. You know, for weight loss, for tracking weight loss or monitoring weight loss, Lose It is a good app. For monitoring sleep cycle, Sleep Diary is a good app. For monitoring your pregnancy status, what to expect is a good app. Another thing we should focus on is that hardware devices, operating systems, and built-in software have been increasingly outfitted for automated data collection. Apple's iPhone now come equipped with a sensor that allow for personalized health monitoring, such as heartbeat, steps, and distance measuring. Android systems are equally furnished to enable monitoring functions. The large majority of apps get distributed through their respective app stores, Apple's App Store and Google Play Store. This is an example of app in a phone. Spiro Smart is a research app to let people test their lung function using only a smartphone. Now let us focus on the education sector. The market for online educational platforms have flourished as schools and colleges and universities have been rushing to implement sophisticated portals that allow students to see course assignment. It also let teachers communicate with students, offer digital courseware, and permit parents to access their children's progress. Intricate data-driven products are designed to adapt to the abilities and pace of each individual child, holding out the promise of improved academic achievement. So one of the platform to be highlighted is Massive Open Online Courses. It is a web-based platform which provides unlimited number of students worldwide with a chance of distance education with the best institute in the world. MOOCs also cause new relationship in the geometrics between the learner, the developer of the content, the delivering and the assessment of education. Now, MOOC program in India. The University Grant Commission, along with the Human Resource Development Ministry, have launched the MOOC program in India for higher secondary, bachelor's, and master degrees. This will cover a wide range of subjects that may or may not be taught in regular campus studies. Swayam is another platform. Swayam is an instrument for self-actualization, providing opportunity for a lifelong learning. Here you can choose from hundreds of courses, virtually every course taught at the university, college, school level, offered by the best teachers in India and elsewhere. If you're studying in any colleges, you can transfer the credit earned by taking these courses into your academic records. If you are working or not working in school or out of school, SWAM present a unique educational opportunity to expand the horizon of knowledge. Coursera is one of the platform that have present. Coursera is a top most provider of MOOCs with over 200 plus courses to offer. Coursera offers content that is preferably free of charge to the end users. Student can enroll and watch videotape lectures, engage in online exercise and take tests. Coursera's goal is to connect educational content to the global mass audience. Coursera positions itself as a connector, connecting content, student and the third parties. So yes, we can see that platform have the different online platforms has changed the entire scenario of traditional education sector. Now the new sector. New sector was transformed through the development of online platform in the late 1990s. I have given a definition by Nicholas Carr, a statement given by him that the newspaper as a product is a bundle of news stories and advertisement. So according to Nicholas Carr, newspaper is a bundle of news stories and advertisement. The rise of online platforms have led to the unbundling and rebundling of news content, audience and advertisement. We can see this illustration, bundle product, a newspaper we get news, commentaries, local advertisement, personal classified ads and job posting. Now, with the help of online platforms, it is resulting in unbundling. So news, we can get news in through Facebook, Newsfeed, Twitter, local advertisement in Google Ad, Facebook, classified ads in Craigslist, and there are more. Let us focus on classified advertisement website. A major step in unbundling this configuration was the development of classified advertisement websites such as Craigslist and eBay. Classified ads had long been an important source of income for the newspaper industry. So this site meant an undermining of one of the sector's prime business model. The migration of the ad to specialized websites should be seen as only the first step in what Carr calls the great unbundling. So from newspaper, different site, different classified advertisement website, we can place our ads in this classified advertisement website instead of placing everything in the newspaper. Now the next thing is search engine. From the early 2000 onwards, search engines with Google leading the pack quickly acquired a dominant position in online advertising, undermining the ability of news organization to generate advertisement revenue. Yet, as Carr point out, search engine also unbundle the content, how audience relationship by allowing user to directly find out and access single news articles and video, circumventing the front page altogether. So we can directly search whatever topic or whatever information we want in the search engine. So the third thing is the news platform is a news aggregator. News aggregator collect content from different news sources such as online newspaper, blogs, podcasts, and video blogs. Aggregator unbundle the content and audience by providing direct access to individual news item. It also rebundle by providing all the content in one location and thus making the aggregator the prime gateway to access news. Prominent examples of news aggregator aggregation website are Google News, Apple News, Yahoo News. Social media platform. Since 2004, social media platform have rapidly become the central node in the platform ecosystem and boosted the process of unbundling. Because we in Facebook, I have given the example of Facebook and Twitter, we no more, in India has 241 million user on Facebook. That's the highest they have in any country. 52% of India use Facebook as a source of news. So yes, we can use social media platforms to get news rather than newspaper, traditional newspapers or traditional news sectors. Twitter, India has 7.75 million users on Twitter. 18% of social media users in India look at Twitter as a source of news. So I would like to conclude by focusing towards a value-centric design of platform society. Societal orders are no longer just cemented in offline institutions and organizations, but they also increasingly are interwoven with the digital constellations. If society wants to create a platform structure that reflects and constructs a democratic order, they need to strive to implement public values and collective interests in the ecosystem design. Public values need to be articulated in each sector and in each context, because they are both the stakes and outcomes in political and ideological contests. Openly articulating and weighing public value at every level is imperative to revamping the platform ecosystem design. Over here, I have given an example of Facebook, how you know we can see that value for the public, value for public is given. Facebook received a lot of criticism concerning its binary approach towards soliciting information about gender and sexual orientation. The company responded by including a range of other, you know, this is the third option, identifying option, including the possibility for user to defy any categorization. This actively influenced social norms by expanding the conventional binary options. Thank you.
Thank you, Jyoti, for such a comprehensive detailed presentation on platform society. Thanks so much for sharing with us. The feedback link is also provided. It's already been posted in the chat box. The participants are requested to fill up the feedback link carefully so that they can receive the e-certificates error free. And it is my honor to invite our HOD, head of the department, Dr. Uma Shankar Pandey, sir. So, your words on platform society.
Thank you so much, Atushi and Jyoti, for such a wonderful presentation. We have some very good attendees in today's session. Am I audible?
Yes.
If Professor Dr. Mohammad Shahidullah is there in the audience, if we can get him to speak something. So are you there, Dr. Shahidullah?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'm here, but I'm mere listener. Don't worry for that. I'm just a listener.
I'm really delighted to listen
to Jyoti's presentation, and I'm really happy to see that it is very new sector that I need to explore for a bit, because all of you are younger than me. So I'm a bit older. I'm not used to use this kind of technology and so-called this kind of issues. So I'm really delighted. Just listener.
Thank you so much, Dr. Shahidullah, one of the most well-known professors from South Asia, and is well-known over different parts of the world as well. So it's an honor that, you know, we've had such wonderful attendees in our web lectures. So this is a very, very important, there are so many dimensions of platform society, and I'm very happy that, you know, our platform is one of the first to have a web lecture on that.
And yes,
Jyoti was very nervous about being the first presenter on Platform Society, but she's done a wonderful job. And I'm sure all of us understand that we are leading into a very new direction of society itself. And we will have to keep on talking about that, because it leads to something known as surveillance economics. I mean, it's no longer just about those companies, you know, using our data, but using the data to influence how we behave, or to predict how people are going to behave. So that's what, you know, all this data is about, you know, whether the voice data, when we ask Siri or Alexa or Google Assistant or anyone to do something. So all this data is used to make predictions about what we might do. So Amazon, for example, knows exactly when to send you the message so that you use your credit card or debit card to buy something which you otherwise might not have bought. So they are influencing us. So it's much bigger than and I've said that on other occasions as well. This is much bigger than just the concepts of privacy or monopoly. It's much beyond that because they are using our behavioral data, whether it's Uber or whether it's eBay or whether it's Google itself or Facebook, for example, and Twitter and everybody else. They have kind of unearthed a gold mine. I mean, something even bigger than a gold mine because, you know, it does not matter to one individual, but it matters to everybody. So, for example, if you ask somebody, say that I'm not bothered, let them take my phone number, let them take all the information because I have nothing to hide. So that kind of a thing is there. But at the same time, what it means is that what it means is that they are using all this information for something which the world is not prepared for. We don't know what the answers are. For example, we can't ask anyone to stay away from these platforms. It is simply impossible. The utility that they're providing, say, for example, for urban transport and somebody who's staying in parts of Calcutta where the old yellow taxis wouldn't go, they know the utility of Uber taxis. You know, it's there right at your doorstep. It's another issue that, you know, all the information Uber exactly knows that when you might go somewhere, et cetera, et cetera. So these are very important issues, and I'm so happy that all our colleagues they have you know dealt with all these very important topics. I take this opportunity to wish everyone a very very happy Navratri. It's a very auspicious day today. It's the beginning of the Devi Pokkho, and what better platform than Surendranath College for Women and Department of Journalism and Mass Communication of our college to celebrate women power. So this is such a wonderful platform and such a wonderful location for all of us. So it started on 22nd August, as we said, and we've had a very, very different kind of presentation, starting from how to do newspaper design to how to do communication research, and then how to, you know, what the development communication is all about and what digital media is all about, and then coming on to sports journalism, and then information society, and then combating infodemic, and the earlier one was on the language of cinema. This is a platform society. So we've covered such a huge range of topics that it will be, and it's such a wonderful thing to listen to, you know, so many, you know, senior professors, and it's such a big encouragement. We've had Suresh Gorji last time, we've had Professor Shahidullah now, and all other senior professors, they have, commended us for this kind of a venture where younger scholars and researchers, they are presenting their point of view in such a wonderful, cogent manner. So again, I must thank all my colleagues, Shottabrata Paul, Shabani Mukhopadhyay, Ushashi Rai Sengupta, Konka Majumdar, Otoshi Bhattacharya, Ananya Sen, and Jyoti Shah. All of them, you've been such wonderful colleagues, and you've done such wonderful work. And if we see, the YouTube videos have come out so well, and the students and researchers, they have been writing to us how much they enjoyed and how much useful they found. Unfortunately, one of our colleagues, she was not well, so she has not been able to present in this series. But immediately after we return in the first week of November, Shravani will have a presentation on photojournalism, basically. So we'll start our second part of the web lecture series in the first week of November, or in the second week of November, and then we'll carry on from there. So again, thank you very much, everyone, for the wonderful presentations, for all the addition, for all the contribution you are making to the knowledge domain in all such wonderful areas, because it takes a lot of effort and it takes a lot of cognitive energy to come out with such wonderful presentations, apart from the routine work that you've been doing. Thanks, Atoshi. Again, you know, you've been multitasking today with more than two hands. So you've been.
Thank you, sir.
you've been the moderator, and you've been, you know, doing the recording, and you've been managing the attendances and all that. So thank you again, everybody. Thank you to all my colleagues. Thank you, Jyoti, for such a wonderful presentation. It does not even appear that this is your first web lecture. You sound very seasoned, and it's very comprehensive, and it's very good. So thank you again. If any of my colleagues wants to say something.
There is just one question in the chat box. I would just read out if Jyoti or you can attend to that. Professor, assistant professor in journalism from St. Xavier's College, Kerala, Bibhu VN. He has asked, put up a question, are these big giants becoming internet gatekeepers or monopolies? And can we expect a decentralized web or D-web in near future? This is what he has to ask.
So with Jyoti's permission, shall I? Yes, sir. Okay, so as I said, you know, we are looking at a very, very new dimension of the entire thing. This is something that we had no idea about. So it overshoots that gatekeeping kind of a thing, because they are there everywhere. They are there in the wearables. I mean, they will be there in all the internet of IoTs that you think about. So it's not just about, you know, you using. It's not just about, and I can just use this word, very responsibly, it's not you searching Google, it's Google searching you to get all that massive amount of information and to use that behavioral surplus to modify our behavior. So a lot of the things we are seeing here is very new. So we are not even sure about, you know, how to, because even if you turn off a lot of the things, you don't know what about that. Because if you were to read all the terms and conditions of every app that you download on your phone, then probably you will require many days to read, you know, all the terms and conditions. And even if you do not accept, if you don't accept it, it won't work. There are so many things, you know, you might have Wi-Fi on your air conditioner. Whenever there is Wi-Fi, means they are, using the information that, you know, who is, or they might even be, you know, listening to what you are, and they don't bother about your permission, because it's not even required. So the regulations that we require, it will take some time coming, because as I said, these are very new kind of things. So how it's not just about how we use the internet, how we, you know, stop all this use of behavioral data. Because as I said, it's not just about privatization. It's much beyond that. It's not just about, you know, being exposed to all such techniques of surveillance. So it's not just about, you know, the state using it. All these giants, they are much bigger than states even. I mean, these days, I mean, you can't have anyone regulating them in a manner they should be regulated. Because they know how to, because and this requires a lot of thought, because when they know how to modulate behavior, they also know how to take care of people who would be, you know, opposing these kind of things. So if I have to just give an example, Google has been doing some wonderful things as well. So the moment they are, you're right, sir. So the moment might be an opponent or whatever, then how to take care of it? The Google News Initiative, for example, and they're doing a lot of all those, what in the earlier paradigm would be regarded as corporate social responsibility. Now they know how to take care of the academies. Now they know how to take care of the pressure groups and of societies and states and all. So all these people, they have been co-opted, and they think that this is natural. This is not natural. This is something beyond that. So platform society has so many benefits. I mean, if the state, for example, were to suggest that, from tomorrow, we are stopping Ola, Uber and all these things. Don't you think there'll be an outrage? People will be out on streets. What are you doing? This is so helpful. And you would know that, you know, this has not just come out like this. I mean, there was a time when for search, you had to pay. I mean, Google had its competitors. And where if you were searching the search engine, you would have to pay to, or if you were not paying, some companies were paying to go up higher on the search results, but yes, Google has used it in a very different manner. They have collected so much information, so it is almost impossible for anyone. Say, for example, if somebody surreptitiously changes the Google search engine and brings something else, wouldn't you immediately go back to Google, because you know their utility is much more. So how we take on these giants is an open question, and this will have to be answered in the years to come, because they are simply so very powerful that they are there in every aspect of our lives. So I hope I have answered that, and thank you for allowing me this opportunity to provide my thoughts on that. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Professor Bivu Vien, for asking the question. It was a surely a value addition. And thank you, sir, for this extra information we got. So with that, I guess I will take this opportunity to thank our principal ma'am as well, Dr. Purnima Vishwas, for extending her support and encouragement. And thank you once again, Dr. Uma Shankar Pandey sir, for always encouraging us and starting this initiative. We will surely come back with more such sessions with our students. So with that, I'll thank all our faculty members, Shrabani Mukhopadhyay ma'am, Shotoboto Paul sir, Ushoshire Sen Gupta ma'am, Konka Majumdar ma'am, Ananya Sen, Jyoti Shah, and Autoshi Bhattacharya. So, thank you everyone. We appreciate you all being here, and thanks for joining us today, and we will surely see you all next time in another session post puja. So happy Navratri to everyone. With that, we end our session for this today. Thank you so much.
Thank you.